Praise the Lord. Let us sing this chorus together.
It's all right, baby. It's all right. Jesus is my
ministry. Thank God for privilege that you counted us worthy to be among the people to be part of this seal. Lord, receive all glory in the name of Jesus. We remember those things that you have done for us and we are grateful. We are also praying that this morning you will visit us again in the name of Jesus. Lord, we commit your church, the thousand, the clergy, and the lady to your hand, that you will empower us in the name of Jesus. Father, at the end of this season, let you be glorified. In Jesus' mighty, wonderful, faithful, and dependable name, we pray. God for this time again, and my sincere thanks to our Diocese, the Right Reverend Isaac Obiwale, who has counted it worthy to invite us to be part of this year's seal. I pray that the ministry that God has committed to his hand will continue to flourish in our midst in the name of Jesus. I also extend my greetings to our fathers in God. For this privilege, the Lord will continue to uphold you in your ministry, and you will never serve in vain in the name of Jesus. We will go straight to the Bible study for today. And the theme that we are considering is fear God. Tell somebody by your side, fear God. And our text is taken from Revelation chapter 14, verse 7. Someone to read for us. Revelation chapter 14, verse 7. Okay, it's on page 30 of our booklet for the synod. The Bible study is on page 30. And so text is reading for us. Revelation 14, 7.
He said in a loud voice.
He said in a loud voice, yes.
Honor God and praise him.
Honor God and praise him.
He said, he said in a loud voice,
yes.
Honor God and praise his greatness.
Yes.
For the time has come for him to judge.
Okay.
Worship him who made heaven, earth, sea, and the spring of waters.
Okay, thank you. New King James Bible says,
say with a loud voice.
Yes.
Fear God.
Fear God.
And give him the honor of his judgment.
Yes.
And his commandment. Worship him. That made heaven and earth, and the sea, and the fountains of the waters.
Praise the Lord. The text says that we should fear God. And in that single verse of scripture, the writer was able to point our attention to one of the reasons why we should fear God. And he says, a casual voice, not with a subtle voice, but with what?
A loud voice.
That tells us the magnitude of the importance of the statement. You know, when God wants to get our attention, in some scriptures in the Bible, you will see words that will express the rate at which God wants us to take that word seriously. And when you hear the words like, surely, behold, then you need to pay attention. But at this time, the Bible says, the angel that God sent, say with what? A loud voice. And says what? Fear God. So, for the purpose of emphasis, and for us to know that this is the mind of God, and that the message is clear and great and important, the angel is also reaching out to you and I with a loud voice today that we should do what?
Fear God.
We should do what?
Fear God.
Our aim to understand what it means to fear God. Like I was trying to explain yesterday, that when they tell you to fear somebody, you kind of you 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 equip yourself more. You prepare. You are more prepared. So that you can handle the person in case anything happens. But when it comes to God, it is a different matter entirely. And how Christians can do say what we are telling you to do or what God is telling us to do is not what is impossible or what has never been done before. No. We want to know how we can do the same. The second aim is to study and learn from biblical characters who fear God and its attendant results. There are characters in the Bible, individuals in the Bible, who are men of God, who are lay members of the church as well. Not all of them could be described as men of God, but they had a relationship with God. So they fear God. These are the people that we said they are biblical characters that want to look at their life. So it won't be as if we are preaching a theoretical sermon to you. It is a practical message that we fear God. I will now consider some people who have done it and what they benefited from it. Then the third aim, to discuss the direction of loyalty of today's Christian. We want to extray our community, our nation, where we belong, where God has placed us. Let us reason together. The Bible says, come and let us do what? Let us reason together. How Christians can fear God in this generation?
Praise the Lord.
And it also appears that we fear man than fearing God. So all of this, we look at this. Introduction. The fear of God sounds as more of instruction than a command. It's an instruction from God. And when God gives you an instruction, he expects that you carry it out. You don't negotiate it. You don't drag it. You don't postpone it. Because the one who is talking is the one who created you and who has the control over your life. So, it's an instruction from God, and we must take it in that light. It's a subtle expression of what it takes to be a complete and true Christian. No one can be said to be a Christian without the fear of God. There is no doubt that this is God's expectation from all his human creatures. You and I are not left out. Every one of us, we are expected to fear God. Often, the word fear is associated with remote or fear threat. But in the concept of our usage, this and this, the character attached, which is God, it depicts an act of reverence. We can revere our fathers in God, and that is why we call them reverend, because they are people of honor. We honor them. But the way we live our lives, do we honor God? Do we revere God? Do we wake up in the morning and wave our hands and raise our voices and say, God, I am grateful? Do we recognize that when we wake up in the morning and we pray, what we are doing is to commit the day to God's hand? And any day that we fail to do so, what we are saying is that, God, let me take control of today. Whatever happens, let me go on. I'm okay. I'm comfortable. Whatever happens. But when we do that, we revere God. We have put him where he belongs and what he expects from us. Obedience. Obedience. This is one of the characteristics of someone who fears God. We obey God's word. We obey authority as placed over us. Then we also respect him. We respect him in our conduct and our way of life. To fear God is good because it separates us completely from the demands of our sinful nature. A man or a woman who fears God will ask himself or herself questions. If I do this, will God be happy with me? If I do this, will God be glorified? If I do this, if Jesus should come today, will I be able to make heaven? So, anyone who will fear God will be completely separated from the demands of sin. What are the demands of this sinful nation? It was read to us yesterday, one of our texts. Lost we a fear of God will separate us from. When we hear that someone is God-fearing, that quality makes us trust that person more. Because if truly they fear God, they are more likely to be sincere in their dealings and treat others with genuine love and kindness. When you hear that that man fears God, he doesn't wear collar, he's not a pastor, that sister fears God, you will want to appreciate with that person. If you want to do business and you get to know that the person you want to do business with has the fear of God, then you will be happy and be contented, because you know that he is going to declare the actual profit that was made and he's going to give you what is due to you. Fear God, not by deception. Truly, genuinely fear God. This is the kind of people that we need. Maybe he will stop leadership in the church, in the nation, in the state, or any place. People that truly and genuinely fear God. Because when they bring the fear of God to anything they do, there will be difference. You know the Bible tells us, he said, when the righteous is in power, what happened? The nation rejoices. The nation will prosper. The people will rejoice and prosper. But when the wicked is in power, what happened? The people will grow. I don't know, maybe that is our situation that you have today. Are we growing under our leadership or we are rejoicing? Then that tells you the kind of people in power, if they fear God or not. To fear God demands that we exhibit self-control. Self-control. Now, it is your responsibility. Nobody will do it for you. You know, God will not come down and force us to his way, to do his will. No. He has placed us with choices. So, your input, your own responsibility, so you have to have self-control. It demands self-control. That sin will present itself before you, but you have the choice to say no. That is self-control. Another thing is what? Self-discipline. We have to discipline ourselves. The world will throw many things at us as Christians, but we need to be disciplined. Then we need to conform to God's will and establish standards. It suffices to say that a genuine Christian must not only understand what it means to fear God, he or she must what? Seek. Underline the word seek. To seek means you work at it. You work for it. You hunger for it. You seek to practice the fear of God, both in season and out of what? Out of season. When, what that means to us is when it is comfortable and when it is not comfortable. You just have to do and display the attitude or the lifestyle that fears the Lord. The grace to do that, God will give to each and every one of us in the name of Jesus. Our discussions is going to be all-encompassing, and it is going to be participatory in nature. We are studying, so I will expect as much contribution as possible while we will still keep within the time that is allotted to us. What do you understand by the statement, fear God, and how can we fear Him? 1 Chronicles chapter 29, verse 11. Someone to read for us. 1 Chronicles chapter 29, verse 11.
And the glory, and the victory, and the majesty for all that is in heaven and in the earth is thine. Thine is the kingdom, O Lord, and thou.
attitude.
What can we say about the concept of fearing God, and how can we fear Him? Okay, sir, I'll be good with you.
From that passage of scripture, to fear God refers to a specific respect and total submission to God, keeping His words inviolate, and honoring Him as God of glory and majesty.
Thank you, sir.
What I really don't know is that to fear God demands that we honor Him when man is there. That we honor Him. We ascribe all glory to Him and we respect Him. Anyone who fears God, you don't create opportunity to honor God in your lifetime or even with the words of your mouth. Then it means you don't have respect for God. But you can see the level of reverence that the writer of this scripture has for God, and he declared openly that God is who? He is the greatest. So he has spread all glory to God, all honor to God, and he actually revered God. And that means he fears God, he respects God. And that is what we are saying, reverence for God. That is what it means to fear God, reverence for God. Thank you, Brian.
Yes, sir. Just like you said, sir, he is the greatest. Because all the greatness lies in Him, and above all, He is worthy to be exalted. No matter what exalts the highest God, He shows the fear that God. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah. Okay? Thank you, ma'am. When you exalt somebody, it means you honor the person, you fear the person. Thank you.
Praise the Lord. From the introduction, fear of God simply means living our lives in the genuine ways of character that speak the mind of God.
Okay. Living our lives in a genuine character that speaks that to favor. It means that we have to be truthful. Am I correct?
Yes.
In our deeds, we have to be what? When you see something that is true, you say it the way it is. Even if everyone around you will not agree, because it is the truth, you do what? You say it. And that's why the Bible says, don't join the multitude to do evil. When it comes to favor, you may not be the only man standing up. Everyone may be against you. Am I correct? But because of the fear of God, you stand for what is true. Thank you. Yes, sir.
Praise the Lord. If we say we fear God, it demands love for our fellow human being. The Bible says if we say we love God and we hate our brothers, we are liars. So we must love our neighbor as we love ourselves. If we fear God, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Okay. Thank you. Now, let me just talk to this. God measures our love for Him, our fear for Him, by the way we keep our very memory. When you treat people around you very well and in fear of God, God is happy with you. And that is where your heart can open. In fact, in the scripture, when God was addressing marriage, He says that men should treat their wife well, so that their prayer can be what? Answered. So if you don't treat your wife very well, that means the heavy woman in life can be short. Your prayer will not be answered. Okay, sir.
Praise the Lord. That place, when you see that, what do you understand by the statement, pray God? In my own understanding,
is that
we should give him the adoration. That's when we are talking about these three words, acts, that ACT. We should give him what? The adoration. That is the honor of everything. That's
in the text that was read to us, 1 Corinthians chapter 11. We say that that woman is a greatness.
He's the one that you ascribe the deep adoration to and give him the word, full respect in everything in our life. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. To fear God means the last conclusion of this, our candidate. To fear God means to give him full respect. Full respect. Thank you.
From the passage we have read, there is four things there that he mentioned for us why we need to fear God. Number one, because of his greatness. Number two, all powers belong to God. And number three, Matthew says that I will not share my glory with anybody. He's glorious. And number four, because of his beauty. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. So for who you are today, who do you give the glory to? For you to speak and wake up this morning, who do you give the glory to? When you give it to him, it means you fear him. If our governor of this state, should come into this meeting as we are at this time now, what do we all do? We will stand up. Am I correct? As he's walking in, everybody will stand up. What do? We honor him. The same way, we should stand up for Jesus.
Stand up for Jesus.
Thank you. So, the Lord will help us in Jesus' name. Proverbs chapter 3, verse 5. Who is reading for us?
Trust in the Lord with all thy heart, and lean not unto thy own understanding.
Okay, thank you. From that scripture, what does it mean? Are you sure we have, we are supposed to read the 6th verse, that's fine. From that scripture, what does it mean to fear God? Okay.
That is exactly what you want to do. Trust in the Lord. No matter what you want to do, whatever project, whatever plan, whatever decision, either you are rich, you are great, whatever, you just trust in God to lead you in the right path. Not with your own wisdom. Even though you are a professor of knowledge, you should believe that there is an Almighty God whom you should trust to direct everything. Praise the Lord.
Thank you, ma'am. Yes, sir.
If we continue in that place, that verse 6, it says something. In all the ways, acknowledge him.
We should do what? Acknowledge God in everything in this life, and he shall direct the what? The path. So when we acknowledge God in our ways, he will do what? Direct our path. So by that part of what? To fear God.
Thank you. That verse passage says, trust in the Lord, joy of heart, and the name not on your own understanding, which means the Bible does not say you should not get understanding. Get understanding, but don't lean on that understanding. Lean on God. That's what the understanding may do. The devil is like this to me. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Praise the Lord. In addition to that, to fear God is to trust him. And reference in Jeremiah 17, verses 5 and 7, is very, very important to note that if we fear God, we will trust him. And when we trust him, God will not bless us according to the verses read. In verse 5, it says that, thus saith the Lord, cause be a man that trusted in man. So if we put our trust in man,
then God will not be happy with us. For those who put their trust in man, it means that they are called by God. And in verse 7, blessed is the man that trusted in the Lord, and whose hope the Lord is. So when we put our trust in the Lord, then we receive blessings from Him. But when we don't put our trust in Him, then God will not be happy with us, and those people are cursed. They are cursed in this world, and they are doomed in the world to come. But if we put our trust in Him, we are blessed in this world, and we have the joy of eternity with Him in the kingdom to come, to be with Him in His everlasting kingdom. Praise the Lord.
Thank you, sir. Okay, let me take this. Now it's a promotion of that.
Praise the Lord. And from chapter 3, verse 1, he specifically says, my son, do not forget my teaching, and he went ahead for length of day, for your understanding, for you to really know my mind, and its equally is when you fear God that you can understand the teaching of the Lord, even in the word of God. From verses 1 to 8, is full of the blessing of the Lord. For anyone that fears me.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Yes. Trust in the Lord with what? All your heart. And lean not on your own understanding. Do you know why? Our understanding is limited. Our understanding is a makeup of our educational background, our academic qualification, our exposure, our connections, relationships that we have, and the knowledge we have acquired. They are what? They are limited. And that is why trust in the Lord with all your heart and don't lean on your own understanding. Your own understanding can fail you. Your knowledge can fail you any time, any day. But when you are led by God, because you fear Him, you trust in Him, you commit your ways to Him. You know, some of us want to travel, maybe from one community to another, from one part to another. Or if it's a long journey, what do we do to our car? We service our car. Am I correct? You check the tire and make sure it is good. Everything is properly done. But most people forget to pray. They forget to pray because even if you service your car, your engine is signed, your tire is good, everything is perfect. Is it not God that grants God mercy? Is it not the one that will make you to get to your destination? Because same road that you are going to pass, many people have had accident on that road. And so we must grow as individuals in our relationship with God. That is what this issue of fear God is telling us. We must grow in our relationship with God such that in everything we do, you want to get married, you trust God. You pray. You want to have a project, your personal house, or whatever, anything you want to do, you trust God for it, you commit to Him. Anything you want to do in life, you commit and trust God for the service of it. And that means that we fear Him. The grace to do so, the Lord will give unto us in the name of Jesus. Let's move to Proverbs 8:13. Praise the Lord Jesus. So the fear of the Lord is to hate evil. How do we hate evil? When you speak lies against your fellow man, it's part of evil that God hates a lot. You preach, but what you preach is against what you do. It's evil, if not the Lord. So before we can say, yes, I fear the Lord, we have to act according to what we do in the presence of God and when men are not even here at all. What we say must follow what we equally do. Anything we do against what we say is evil before the Lord. We have to forbid it so that the fear of God can be made manifest in our life. Isaiah 33 has said it all. A woe to the spoiled, who was not even, has not been spoiled. Because when the day he stopped doing that, he will be completely destroyed. So we should have this at the back of our mind. The Lord will help us and change us there.
More contributions.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, sir.
Reference to Proverbs chapter 3, verse 7, with where we read in the scripture Proverbs chapter 8, verse 13. That Proverbs chapter 3, verse 7 says, "Be not wise in your own eyes. Fear the Lord and depart from evil." So if we say we have the fear of the Lord, we should depart completely from evil. We must not allow evil in our lives. In everything we do, we must allow God to reign, and we do everything in the fear of God. And that Proverbs chapter 8, verse 13 says, "The fear of God is the hate of evil." So if we compare the two together, as a Christian, in any form, we must not allow evil. And if you look at our churches today, churches are full of evil. Some Christians' families are full of evil, and still we still say we fear the Lord. But from this Bible study, if we say we fear the Lord, we must not allow evil at all to live in our churches and in our homes.
Thank you, sir. Yes, he said even in churches, there are what? There are what? Okay, they said even in the midst of men of God, there is what? But the Bible says we are the light of God. Do you agree with me then? It means that we are now responsible. We are part of the problem of the community. Yes. Of Nigeria, we are the leader of our community. So if there are no evils in church, then the community outside there will be better off. Am I correct? Then we need to speak to ourselves. The Bible says to fear God is to depart. When the word depart is a sharp word, completely off. It is a move. No, it's a depart. It's a sharp word, action word. Depart, you off it. We must, we must do what? Hate evil, hate. So as Christians, as brothers and sisters, as beloved of God, God is still hoping in us. And his expectation is that we will depart from evil. Evil of covetousness, evil of lies, evil of fornication, evil of adultery, evil of stealing. These are the evils that God, and many more, that God wants us to depart from. Because we fear him. The grace to do so, the Lord will keep on to us in the name of Jesus. Proverbs 23, 17 to 18.
"Let not thy heart envy sinners, but be thou in the fear of the Lord all thy day long. For surely there is an end, and thy expectation shall not be cut off."
Okay. From that scripture, what do we understand by saying, "When fear God and have a room in him"? Okay. Yes, sir. There are people who have not contributed. Please, I don't. Let me not point at you. I believe we are all listening. So please, we need one.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
In this passage, fearing God means to be contented with what God has provided for you. You should not look at another person's achievement. How come? From here, evil thought will begin to emanate. But if you trust God wholeheartedly, He said your expectation will not be cut off. Fearing God means you should be contented with whatever God has provided for you. Praise the Lord.
Thank you, sir. Okay, I'm writing here.
When we look at verse 18, for surely
there is a hereafter. Hereafter. That's time of judgment. When you understand what awaits the punishment that awaits sinners at the end of the day, then even if it's popular to join sinners, even if it is majority doing it, but it's against God, when you put your heart to consider hereafter, you will stand with God and do His will.
Thank you, sir. Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord. From that verse 18 also, Bible says that for surely there is an end, and you and your expectation shall not be put off. And if we consider this with that verse 17, when we see sometimes sinners prosper, and Christians every day. If you see sinners around you making it, especially in a border, Bible says we should not focus attention to them. But here God is telling us that as a Christian, and if we have the fear of God, our expectation will not be put off. And some Christians today, when they pray, after 2 days, 3 days, when there is no answer, they look for alternative. But Daniel waited until God answered his prayer. So as a Christian, if you have the fear of God, when we make a request known to God, we must wait and receive answer from God. Because there is assurance in that verse 18 that our expectation as a Christian that have the fear of God will not be cut off. And our expectation prophetically in this synod will never be cut off in the name of Jesus.
Thank you, sir. The Bible says godliness with contentment is what? It's a great gain, not just ordinary gain. It's a what? Great gain. So, if we fear God, we will be contented. Then eventually we'll be able to reign with Him when we depart this sinful world. Because the truth be said, even if you and I are prepared to spend 200 years here, one day we'll do what? We'll die. If 250, even if you spend 250 years, one day we'll die. And after death, there is what? Judgment. And God will be fair to every one of us. So we should be conscious of that. We should be mindful of that. Let's move on to 2 Corinthians 7:1. Who is there? 2 Corinthians 7:1.
Having done all these promises, dearly beloved,
let us cleanse ourselves from all filthiness of the flesh and spirit, perfecting holiness in the fear of God.
Contribution. In fact, yes, no one has contributed from this side. You are part of us, man. Please, I want response from this side.
according to that scripture.
Okay.
I'll read the brief part. Thus cleanse ourselves of all fittingness of the flesh and the spirit, perfecting holiness in the fear of God. That is, we fear God by doing away with anything that can make us guilty in the sight of God, anything that can make us a sinner, anything that can make us not worthy to enter into the throne of God. We should do away with everything.
Thank you. Holiness in words and actions.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you, sir. Holiness.
That means holiness galvanizes fear of God. Holiness is a catalyst to the fear of God. It enhances it. It speeds up the reaction. When you live in holiness, a typical example biblically is the man of the East, Job. Job lived in holiness. He stood out. How many of us are standing out today? I look at it, it's easier said than done. How many of us can really stand out like Job, even in our various homes? In our classrooms, in our various offices, can you really stand out? It's easier said than done. Even in the clergy house, among the laity, how many of us can really stand out? How many of us can really say, yes, I am living in holiness, I am living in the fear of God? Check it, shake it, about somebody or not only see, or not only Bawalenu. If we are living in the fear of God, then Nigeria would have changed. I look at it this way, it's easier said than done. Because it's a prayer that God will help us to live in the fear of God. Anyway, I think it takes grace to live in the fear of God. For somebody like Job, it is grace. Even right from his own home, war was waged at him. In his own home. And he stood out. His wife told him, you better curse God and die. Other than suffering. So I think it is more of grace. We should ask for God's grace. Let us look at Nigeria. Assuming we are living in the fear of God, what would our country be today? It's our prayer that God will help us in Jesus' name.
Without holiness, no man shall do what? No man shall do what? No man, no woman, without holiness, no man. That is what God has told us. That is where he has placed us. So, in fairness to all of us, what do you think we should strive at on daily basis?
Holiness.
If we truly want to see God, that holiness will materialize in the way we fear God. And as we fear God, we find ourselves getting better and being holy on daily basis. In grace to do so.
To us in the name of Jesus.
Please permit me to go to the second question so that we can properly manage our time. From the following scriptures, identify biblical characters who fear God in the face of challenging realities of life and the results of their actions. Daniel chapter 1, verse 8 to 10 to 20. Who is speaking for us?
But Daniel proposed in his heart that he will not defy himself with the portion of the king's meat.
Please start again, yes.
But Daniel proposed in his heart that he will not defy himself with the portion.
meat and your drink. For why should he see your face was like liking than the children wish of your sorts? Then shall ye make me endanger my head to the king. Then said Daniel to Melzer, which the prince of the angels has set over Daniel, Ananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, prove thy servants, I beseech thee, 10 days, and let them give us pulse to eat, and water to drink. Then let our countenance be looked upon before thee, and the countenance of the children that eat of the portion of the king's meat, and as thou seest, be with thy servants. So he consented to them in this matter, and proved them 10 days. And at the end of 10 days, their countenance appeared fairer and fatter in flesh than all the children which did eat a portion of the king's meat. Thus, Melzer took away the portion of their meat and the wine that they should drink, and gave them pulse. As for these 4 children, God gave them knowledge and skill in all learning and wisdom, and Daniel had understanding in all visions and dreams. Now at the end of the days that the Lord has said he should bring them in, then the prince of the innocent brought them in before Nebuchadnezzar, and the king communed with them, and among them all was found not like Daniel, Ananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. Therefore stood they before the king, and in all matters of wisdom and understanding that the king inquired of them, he found them 10 times better than all the magicians and astrologers that were in all their realms. This is the word of God.
Thank you.
So, biblical characters from that scripture. Okay, our brother.
Praise the Lord. According to that passage, the people character that stood up for God and that faced God is Daniel. And the second part of the question says, what is the result of the action? Because Daniel feared the Lord and stood up for God, even while he was in exile, the Lord made him outstanding among his peers. And in the words of this passage, that if you can't stand up for God, you can't stand up among your peers. Praise the Lord.
Yeah. Thank you very much. We have other characters apart from Daniel. Who are those other characters?
Ananiah,
Mishael, and Azariah. What do we call them? Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Yes, these 4 men, they did what? They stood out. They feared God, and they didn't hide it. So, God made, grant, the Bible says in that scripture I read, that they found favor in the sight of God. They were promoted, they were elevated above others, and they were 10 times better than others. So as a student, when you don't join them to cheat, when you don't join them to compromise, expect that God will respond by granting you favor, and he will elevate you, and you will prosper, and you will be successful.
Praise the Lord.
Genesis chapter 39, verse 1 to 12.
And Joseph was brought down to Egypt, and Potiphar, an officer of Pharaoh, captain of the guard,
an Egyptian, bought him of the land from the Tishamanite, which had brought him down to Titan. And the Lord was with Joseph, and he was a prosperous man, and he was in the house of his master, the Egyptian. And his master saw that the Lord was with him, and the Lord made all that he did to prosper in his hand. Joseph found grace in his sight, and he served him, and he made him overseer over his house, and all that he had he put into his hand. And it came to pass from the time that he had made him overseer in his house, and over all that he had, that the Lord blessed the Egyptian's house for Joseph's sake. And the blessing of the Lord was upon that he had in the house and in the field. And he left all that he had in Joseph's hand, and he knew not aught he had, save the bread which he did eat. And Joseph was a godly person, a
and well favored. And it came to pass after these things that his master's wife cast his eyes upon Joseph, and she said, "Lie unto me." But he refused, and said unto his master's wife, "Behold, my master looketh not what is with me in the house, and he hath committed all that he hath to my hand. There is none greater in this house than I, neither thy heart he kept back anything from me but he, because thou art his wife. How then can I do this great wickedness and sin against God?" And it came to pass, as she spoke to Joseph day by day, that it happened not unto her to lie by her and to be with her. And it came to pass about this time that Joseph went into the house to do his business, and there was none of the man of the house there with him. And she caught him by his garment, saying, "Lie with me." And he left his garment in her hand and fled and got him out. This is the word of God.
Can we identify the biblical character there and the result? Okay, sir.
Those passages of scripture, you can see how Joseph was able to manifest a strong resistance to temptation, and as a result of which he was placed in the place of honor, status, and wealth.
Okay, he manifested strong resistance. Strong what? Against sin. That was the manifestation of a life that fears God. The devil came in human form, but he was also strong to withstand the devil, and he stood for God. And he escaped. And all these things put together got him favor from God. He was great. He was promoted. I pray where God has proposed for you, you will get there in the mighty name of Jesus. No sin will be able to stop you in the name of Jesus. But you need to fear God on your path to greatness. Many things will happen, but you need to fear God. Okay, sir.
The message we derive from that passage. Fear God. Whatever we are doing, let's have it in mind that there is someone, somewhere. He is looking at us. Your boss may not be there. Your master may not be there. But let us have it in mind that God is looking at us. He is going to judge us at the end of our life.
Thank you, sir. God is a rewarder of those who was diligent. Not a rewarder of those who saved him. The rewarder of who? Those who diligently. Joseph was diligent. He escaped all the answers and everything again. Yes, sir.
Last hour of that. I just want us to look at verse 9b.
I want us to look at that verse 9b. He says, "How then can I do this great wickedness and sin against God?" Hallelujah. I want us to know that whatsoever we do to our fellow brethren, we are doing it to God. Hallelujah. Either good or bad, we must acknowledge that whatever we do, either good or bad, we are doing it to God. So if it's bad, we know you are already going out of His will. So he acknowledged that doing that is not sin to his boss, but to God. And that was why he was able to resist the temptation. I pray the Lord help us in Jesus' name. So when you think you have power, when you think I can do this, if I do it, nobody can challenge me, nobody can kill me, nobody can have love, I am the vicar of the church, I am this and that. Believe what you are doing it to God, not even to subordinate. The Lord bless us in Jesus' name. Okay, let me take those two contributions, then we close on that.
Thank you, sir.
How can I make this so complicated and sin against God?
Praise the Lord. Please permit me, I will say my own room. Am I permitted?
Yes.
Ti aba mo bi ti won ka fun ba ye ko to di pe ara pun yen le so pe to ba se ni pe mo se si olorun it is because he feared God sugbon mo fe ki opo lopo wa ka wo ti a se loni because we don't look at the percussion awo atupo to ta se loni but every opo lopo pe they will be doing evil thing and still they will still be doing what? What else? You are supposed yes. So that I go and I'm pulling it or the weeping if they were born. In fact, if I can also let my phone come to some people, she asked me something happened. No, she could go out with two and go down. She could go out with two and happen. No, no, no. To look at that, no, no, no. You want to get there, you want to get there.
Local government. Before election,
We know what is happening. Money, the people we look at, the highest bidder, those who will pay the highest sum of amount in each political party, that is the person they will vote for. That means that we are not standing out. That is determined. We look at food that will be distributed, rice, beans, meat, etc. It means that we are not standing out. And this passage, the message for us today, this year, 2021 Synod, the second section of the 6th Synod, is that we should fear God. And we are moving towards 2023 election. Many campaigns are going on that ground. We should stand out. We should be determined. Lectures should be given in our churches. As Christians in each political party, we must be different. It's not to just crack brain and just to say it and just go like that. It means that individually and collectively, in that sense of it, it's okay. If we change, it will affect lives positively throughout the country. God will help us in Jesus' name. The adage of Yoruba, Onipe anything wafa wofu. So we must not join them. This is what is affecting us in the country today. I pray that God will help us in Jesus' name. So 2023 is coming. We should stand out individually as it does. God will help us in Jesus' name. Then secondly, another magical character that we found here is Joseph. Joseph said, how shall I do this thing and sin against God? Hallelujah. Look at the statement, and sin against God. Joseph stood out. He stood out in his own generation. How many of us are standing out in our generation today? Many before marriage, there are diverse forms of marital sex. And also, married people, they are not left out. I live in a university environment. It means that parents, we need to do a lot. We need to work more on our students. Their son, they put on godly character when they are at home, when parents are there with them. But when they get to higher institution, they put on another character entirely. So as parents, we must fear God. And we must train our children to fear God. What some of them do at home is different from what they do in the institution. So the life of Joseph is a challenge to us today. When we look at dressing, even in the house of God, many you will look at them and are these Christians in the past. Even when you look at prostitutes and you look at Christians, you know the difference. But today, we cannot find difference between those of us who call ourselves Christians and those who are ungodly. From dressing, both men and women, you see men putting on earrings, piercing their nose, and doing their hairstyle and the rest are not godly, even women. So this passage to us, biblical character of Joseph, and also Daniel and the rest are a great challenge to us to emulate in our generation today. We are talking about it that they stood out. We also, we must fear God. God will help us in Jesus' name.
Amen. Thank you, sir. Okay, on that note,
yes.
Just a final question. Thank you very much, sir. I want to make a distinction so that we understand this Bible passage from Revelation chapter 14, verse 7, fear God. It's quite different from the fear of God, the article D and of, make a difference. Because fear, when you fear God, it cannot be measured. You can't measure it. That's, but the fear of God itself is what you benefit from it, the fear of God. The results and the outcome of the fear of God, we can find it in so many passages. But the fear of God, fear
God itself. Let's only open Deuteronomy chapter 10, verse 12, so that we understand the distinction between fear God and the fear of God. The fear of God includes mercy, includes goodness, alright, that we say it before God. So it's not something as human that we just say, okay, because they are doing this, alright, and they say, alright. No human can measure the fear of God. It's not measurable. So we must understand that one. Deuteronomy 10, 12.
And now, Israel.
Yes, this time.
And now, Israel.
Yes.
What does the Lord your God require of you?
Yes.
But to fear the Lord your God, to walk in all his ways, and to love him, and to serve the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul.
Every time we are having communion, fear of God is always pronounced by every pastor, every priest, alright? That fear God, alright, is something that we must imprint in our heart. But the fear of God is the result of your inner mind, of the fear that you have, not the. That's not the distinction I'm trying to make. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. The last scripture we have is Daniel 3, verse 16 to 18. There, okay.
Sidrach, Meshach, and Abednego answered and said unto the king, O Nebuchadnezzar, we shall not be able to answer thee in this matter. If it be so, our God, who we serve, is able to deliver us from the burning of fiery furnace, and he will be deliver us out of the hands of. But if not, be it known unto thee, O King, that we will not serve thee gods, nor worship the golden image which thou hast set up. 24. And then Nebuchadnezzar the king was escorted, and rose up in haste and spake, and said unto his counselor, you know, we cast three men bond into the midst of the fire. The answer and said unto the king, true, O God. O King. Then the 28 to 30. Then the Nebuchadnezzar spake and said, blessed be the God of Sidrach, Meshach, and Abednego, who has sent his angel and delivered his servants that trusted in him, and have charged the king's ward, either their body, that they may not serve nor worship any God except their own God. Therefore, I make a decree that every people, nation, language, who speak anything amidst the king God of Sidrach, Meshach, and Abednego shall be caught in spite of their houses, shall be made a donkey, because he is on other God that can deliver after his thoughts. The last one. Then the king promoted Sidrach, Meshach, and Abednego in province of Babylon.
Thank you, sir. Praise the Lord. In that scripture, we noted that there are three redeemed characters, Meshach, Shadrach, and Abednego, who stood and refused to bow to the God that was set up. And based on that action, Nebuchadnezzar promoted him, and he declared in the whole territory that everyone should serve God of what? Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Because they fear God, just because they fear God, they want the entire what? Territory for God. So when you fear God, your life will not on the people around you. Your life will not on your community. And when you fear God, because of you, many will surrender to God. Will give their lives to God. In grace to fear God, God will be more for us in the name of Jesus. So, I understand the brothers and the result of the actions. Question 3,
We live in a generation where many individuals seem to fear man instead of God. Why is this so? Why is this so? Okay, sir. Yes. Very brief, please.
Praise the Lord. The question is, why is this so? The simple answer to it is, we don't fear God. Because if we fear God, we will not fear common mortal above him mortal. Because Israel is quite disciple. If the so-called Christians, in fact, unfortunately, our stand before God contribute to how our country is dwindling in destruction. Our stand before God contribute to how Nigeria is going backward. Our stand before God as Christians contribute to how Fulanis and others are treating Christians in the northern parts. Our stand before God contribute to how our life is in different churches. So the answer to that is we don't fear.
Thank you, sir. I'll just take two. Okay. Sir. There's someone there who has not said anything this morning. I want us to just pray.
Thank you for giving me the privilege to ask that question. So, like those people that have contributed since this pandemic, they have been hammering on various things that entails the fear of God. But I want to say this, considering that there is a particular verse in the proverb that we used to say, even those who cannot read, they will say that the fear of God is the beginning of wisdom. It is the foolishness of a man to fear the creator than the creator. God is the creator of everything that we see and can feel. But the immortal is that as to our God. Why the creator is immortal? Now and again, sir, we fear men today because we know that they can judge instantly, but God is the God who is full of compassion. He's a very compassionate God that changes his mind when he sees the heart of repentance in that particular person. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. A lot of people said that they agree with you,
yes,
that you have given us the answer.
Yes.
Let's give the answer together for Jesus. So, let's move to question 3, please. Okay.
Praise the Lord. Because the question is, why do men fear men more than God? And the reason is, men live by sight. We live by what we can see, what we can hold, what we can behold. When I speak, they say, Buhari is coming here today, and he will be here by 1 p.m. And anybody who is not inside will be locked outside. All of us will be inside. If they say 5 million, go. So we live by sight. Men live by sight. We live by what we can see. We live by what we can get immediately. And so we hear men who can make a pronouncement and do it instantly, like he said. So, but God is a God of order. He's a compassionate God who will deal with us according to his mercy and compassion. And so we try to perceive God. And so we do things the way we do it. Praise the Lord.
Thank you. I don't want us to, it's a question that can take off the next 1 hour. I'm telling you, I thought we'll have some time with the Lord to be able to dwell on it because it touches many aspects. But the fact that we'll be able to make our points, that's as far as God is concerned, we can't see him, then our reward is not immediately. Those of us who fear men, we fear men because of what we are going to get now. So, but there is a need for us to reorientate ourselves. And it boils down to individual. Now assess yourself, do I fear man more than God? Because it is some people came late here today, not because anything happened, but because anytime I get there, I'm okay. Then it's just that complacent. Not that anything happened, really. But it still boils down to the way you take God's work seriously is an expression of how you fear God. All these things, they are things that we can continue to see. And the Lord will help us in Jesus' name. So let us all go and work on ourselves. Sir?
I just want to say to support you.
Okay,
and
that,
support our
father. Okay, sir. Thank you.
My father used to say that if God will sit in the chancel every Sunday and deal with late comers, that nobody will come to church late. So this morning the bishop is not alive. Many of the clergy came late to the service. So I believe that what Baba said this morning, that we fear men than God, because we can see them face to face. So if I'm losing a point.
Yes, he said many clearly. He said many clearly. He didn't exclude anybody. So thank you, sir.
Yes, sir.
Let's put our hands together for Jesus. In the context of Matthew chapter 10, verse 27 to 31. Yes.
Fear. So why? Because you don't have the full knowledge of the word of God.
whom do we want to fear? And praise the Lord.
Okay, sir. The last contributor. That's the last word. Praise the Lord. I just want to support what my sister has said with the description. It has directed to us that we should not fear man that can kill the body and cannot kill the soul. David is an apposite example because David has experienced the manifestation of God's power in his life. He knew how God helped him to kill him. He knew, he understood the word of God, and that was why he was not afraid of Goliath. He even said that, you come to me with arrow, with spear, and anything of that is true. But I come to you in the name of God. So if we know God, and we are having our perfect standing in the Lord, we will not fear any man. If we have experienced the manifestation of God's power in our life before, we understand the word of God, we will not fear man. We will not fear man in the midst of temptation, in the midst of tribulation, in the midst of trials. We will take our stand, and the victory will be ours in Jesus' name.
Amen. Thank you. Let us hear the conclusion of the matter. Fear God and what? Fear God and what? And keep his conclusion. Anybody who belongs to Christ must fear God. The fear of God in our daily living requires conscious effort on our part. So it is your duty, it is your call, it is your responsibility to fear God. And you must make it happen. More importantly, it always requires the leading of the Spirit of God. Diligence, commitment, and be focused. Because you are running a race, you don't allow yourself to be distracted. Focus on the end, which is eternal life. And that will be our portion in the name of Jesus. It also demands that we do the will of God at all times. We do the will of God at all times. Let us bow down our heads for prayer. Yes, can you pray for us? Pray for us. O Lord Jesus,
amen.
O Lord Jesus,
amen.
O Lord Jesus,
amen.
I'm going to go to the hospital. 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 I'm going to go to